Admin on the chat room. And everybody, if there's any complaint, we'll revert to admin. Admin, answer this. Admin, do this. I'm the Kenegbeto Kun. You are all welcome. And what's going to happen today is today we are going to take you on the touring aspect of it here. And by God's grace, tomorrow we are going to go to farm. And our farm is going to come as early as possible tomorrow. You know, farmer used to go to farm as early as possible because of the sun and the other thing. And so that we can be able to meet up with everything that we wanted, we are about to cover. Today on, we are going to make sure that we don't waste our time. And Mr. Emi is coming out now. When it's time for us to go to have a break, we should do that. And when it's time for us to resume back, we do it immediately. We don't want to wait for anybody any longer. People are still coming. But by the grace of God, we'll get there soon. In the mighty name of Jesus. Mr. Emi is a trainer and he's a professional on this. Mr. Emi is a very, very open-minded person. He's ready to give you everything that you know about this particular thing that we are doing. This is a profitable pig farming. That is not about something that you just have a farm and you're not able to have a profit on it. This one will make you to attain the greater height that you are, you wish to attain on this particular thing that you are doing. And I believe when you are focused on it and when you make yourself available to us by giving you our door is open. You can contact us for anything, you can consult us for everything that you needed to make sure that you are succeeding in everything that you want to do. Most of the people that you have came before, they went to their farm throughout this week. That is why we have a lot of our time was very, very tight. write to their family to know how they are doing. And most of them are doing fine. And we give God all the glory. But today, home, I want you to set your mind, open your ear very well, and make sure you hear and you be a doer of what you are hearing today. And God will make you to do it by the name of Jesus. Open your heart as I call on Mr. Yemi to come and take us to hear for what we are here to do.
Come in. Thank you very much for coming. It's going to be an exciting time today. And I believe that it's going to be worthwhile for you. We've done a lot of work up to this morning trying to make sure everything goes well. And we're going to try as much as to cover as much as possible. What I would recommend as we go along is that if you have any questions, don't wait till the end. Ask me. The reason why we are here is because of you. So don't wait till the end before you ask me questions. If I talk and you say, I see you didn't get it, just ask me again. I wouldn't mind. That's what I'm trying to say. I wouldn't mind. It's going to be an interesting day. Let me just set my slides. Like I said, once again, welcome to the 2-day profitable pig farming. I know many of us have been to farm training before, or even pig farming training. But the emphasis that this training is going to bring is going to be on the profitable aspect. Most of the things I'm going to be saying are going to be emphasizing profitability. How do we run our pig farm to make it profitable? And it's going to be fun. We promise you that it's going to be exciting, it's going to be educative, it's going to be informative, it's going to be interactive. I will suggest at this point that one of the reasons why we normally gather together, people always like me, you know, I don't know whether some of you here have requested that I come to do one-to-one training with them. And I tell you, that's not the best way to utilize my time, and you might not be able to afford it. The importance of coming together like this is that we get to start networking. So by the time we leave, we should have telephone number, because we're in the same business. We should exchange telephone numbers so that we can. If you need to, you can call each other. For example, if I buy PKC, PKC is now 45, 46 naira. If you happen to be able to find it for 40 naira, there's no reason why you cannot call me and tell me you can get a better deal. If you sell your pig, you're not going to afford the sale of my pig. You know, people say, would you want to take full life on account? So I'm going to make it participatory. Tomorrow, between your coming, don't play this night tomorrow. Because you're going to do a lot of things with pigs. And some of that are going to be messy. But the idea behind it is to start making you to have an idea of how a day in the lab of a pig farmer or pig provider is going to look like. So tomorrow we're going to be washing the pen. Tomorrow we're going to be deworming the pigs. Tomorrow we're going to be castrating. Tomorrow we're going to be giving subcutaneous injection, intramuscular injection. We're going to try and see which animal is ready for mating. We're going to talk a lot about that today. The way the session is broken down is today we're going to talk a lot about theory. And the first section of today is going to focus on the commercial. We're going to look at figures. We're going to look at marketing. We're going to look at what makes people profitable. So by the time you're having lunch, you have gone through a lot of figures. Please bear with us and try to simplify, but it's very important that we know how money is made in this business. And that's where we're going to put emphasis on. Because I believe that come on this training, they are not just farmers, they are providers. They are people that want to do commercial farming. And we don't go into this thing just to have animals, like a rich animal, you know what I'm talking about. We go in it to make profit. So how the profit is made and how the loss is made, it's good for us before we dabble into it to know it in detail. I'm going to start this training with an introduction. And theorist of one of the American presidents, I don't know which one, I think it's 22 or 23rd president of America. He said, the more you know about the past, the better prepared for you are for the future. So we're going to take a quick look at the history of Nigeria as a whole in farming. Agriculture in Nigeria has gone and started right from the beginning, even before the pre-colonial time. And this is very important because even in the pre-colonial time, I'm going to give you a slide of this, by the way. So I normally don't give slides at the beginning because people start writing, people start looking and not be concentrating. And you can always switch a slide anyway, anytime when you get to it. So I'm going to give you, so don't bother to write too much. All of this, anything you see here, I'm going to give it to you. Right? If there's any other thing that's not here, feel free to just read that. The history of agriculture in Nigeria has been before colonial. And the reason why that's very important is because even before colonial, our forefathers have been able to provide enough food for themselves. And not only that, they've been able to produce cash crops, which were able to use for trade for trade by barter in this trans-Saharan trade. Now, during the colonial era, which lasted between 1861 to 1960, when the British came here, they discovered that we were very good in agriculture. So they said, I don't know why they decided to teach us technology like India. They made us to focus on agriculture. And they did that because their industry was just starting and they need raw material from us. So they break Nigeria into three categories. The north, the northern region from dry north. They broke us up according to what we can produce, which is very essential. Even our flag, green, white, green, symbolizing that agriculture is very important to us. You understand where I'm taking us to? Because I believe it's very important for us to understand why we are here now. 5 years ago, 10 years ago, we might not sit down in a class to talk about pig farming. But right now we are, and there's a reason why that is. And the reason, and again, I want to emphasize why it's so important that people like me and you are the agriculture, the future of feeding this country lie more in our hand than any other category. You understand as I go along. So they broke us into, they divide us. They divide us based on our region. They didn't even divide up our language. They then say, okay, you Yoruba people focus on cocoa. If you are from the east, focus on palm oil. If you are in the north, focus on groundnut. And that's how they look at us. They don't look at us as Yoruba people that much. In the Second World War, when UK were having problems with food, the Nazis blocked them, they could not bring food. They were counting on our farmers to provide food for them, to help them relieve food shortage during the World War II. Now, even after the colonial era, our founding fathers discovered that our strength is agriculture. And there are a lot of things they've done. There are a lot of schemes and initiatives that they put together to help this. One is farm settlement. We don't know all of it, but we know Operation Feed the Nation. Many of us here, I'm sure all of us here know Operation Feed the Nation wherever we are on. We know FADAMA. We know Additional Cultural Transformation Agenda. Now, our history of agriculture was broken, was interrupted when oil came into being. And oil was not a problem, but it changes the way we think, it changes the paradigm. Suddenly people find it a symbol of poverty to be in the rural area because good jobs are in the city. And that's why most of people leave the village and go to the city. And Nigeria that used to export most of these things in the past automatically became an importer themselves. Until now, because during the oil time we have the money to buy it, so we don't need to produce it, but we have the money to buy it. But right now, we don't have the money to buy it, so because of the drop in oil prices, so we're being forced to go back to agriculture. Now, what do we learn from that story? The challenges have not changed. The challenges, 65% of people that still farm in Nigeria are still using crude method, and we're going to go into why they do that. We still have storage problems, that's why during the tomato season, there are a lot of tomatoes, it goes down to about 20 for 200 naira. And suddenly during the scarcity, when it's no longer available, it goes to the same five for 500 naira. We still have service plus, we need to go to some of our market in the city, you see how much waste takes place all the time. See? Infrastructure, when interest is tomorrow, you don't know how much infrastructure affects agriculture. Tomorrow you will notice it. Because one of the things I've been talking here is that when you're planning your farm, there's some basic things you need to put in place even before you even start thinking about when you're thinking of buying your land that can affect, that can determine the productivity and the profitability of your farm. And if you get it wrong, the farm we're going tomorrow, you will see why it's so important that we're going to be profitable as a big farmer. It starts from buying the land. Where the land is, how far the land is to the main road. Because you as a proprietor will not be on the farm, we're going to talk about that. But you need to be able to visit your farm often as much as possible. I'm certain farmer doesn't work, but I won't jump the gun. I'm moving through this quickly because it's historical. And you know how it is in your life, but it's very important for us to know it. Now, all the initiatives that government have done so far in Nigeria, both the colonial master and Nigerian government, has focused on two categories of people. There are small farm owners, people that are subsistence farmers, and they also focus on large commercial farms. That's very important because these two categories, as much as government has invested in them, they've not been able to feed Nigeria, because if they have been right now, Nigeria should not be having food shortage. Especially when more than 65% of our population are into agriculture. The large commercial farms, we're going to look at them very quickly. Let's look at the elimination of this two category. And I'm by the end you see how we come in. We are in this room. Where we come in, by time I finish. Now, what are the challenges of smallholders? One, they have to less than 2 acres. According to NCO, they use crude implement to farm. They don't have enough money to expand their farm. Return on investment is least of their concern. The quality went into farming to supplement their whatever they have, because if you are in the village and you are a teacher or you are, and you don't have enough money, in the evening you take your student to your farm to come and farm for you. So you can bulk up your salary. Now, what happened again, that the children who grew up in this environment saw their father working, slaving, and not becoming very rich. And most of them decided they never going to be farming. And hence, we are in a generation whereby, look at the criteria of what's over here. The people underneath us, most of us are going to school, we did a little bit of agriculture. Most of the people underneath us, especially those that are going to private school, know nothing about agriculture. And that's going to be the challenge that we have. Not in our own generation, but in the next generation coming, because at least by the time we think deep enough, we'll receive the product of agriculture in the past, maybe in a small scale, and we have a background to build on. What about the large-scale farmer? People say, let's have a study of this world, any general, there are a lot of generals. Somebody was telling me yesterday, with permission, that one of the Nigerian ministers had a very, very big farm in the east. He was surprised when he got to the farm and discovered that as big as the farm is, it's being run down. They're supposed to have more than 2,500 pigs. They ended up having, they have less than 800 now. And the state of those animals was very, very poor. Now, why? Empirical data have shown that big farm, that's one of the things that we emphasize. Your goal is not to have the largest farm in the Edo State or in Ibadan or in Enugu or wherever you come from. Your goal is to have a profitable farm. That's why you put money into it, you won't be able to get your money back. So you're motivated to put more money into it and get your money back, and it becomes a cycle. And you're comfortable with it. So it's not going to be, at the end of the day, it's not going to be how big your farm is. It's how profitable. But one thing I know, if it's profitable, you'll be motivated to make it big. But what I'm saying, make it profitable first before you start becoming zero to make it big. Very important. Data have shown it. And the reason for that is that if I'm having a small farm and I'm doing it myself, I'll do it very well. If I employ people to do it for me, they will not do it as I want to do it. I wanted to have these government farms, institution farms. You only need to go to almost all these institutions that are called research institutions. You continue to wonder, what are they researching? Case in point, well, right now in Nigeria, we need good breed of pigs. We have many research institutions in Nigeria. How come up this time no institution have invested in pigs? So that we farmers, I will tell you, one of the challenges you have as a farmer, you have to be the farmer, the nutritionist, the veterinary doctor, the marketer, the procurement officer, the human resource manager. All of you have to be, even when it comes to genetics, you have to be genetics. Because also in other countries, there's a division of labor, and what happened is that nobody is carrying it, but in Nigeria, you have to do pig farming, you have to do all of it together. And that's why we're under tremendous strain, and that's why we cannot afford to get it wrong. Because if we do, if we only need to make mistake in one and you are afraid to rest, we're going to be looking at that in more detail. And again, contrary to popular opinion, corporate farms, a good example is the Zimbabwe farm in Ilorin. They don't do anything for the community. If you go to your village and you go and do farming, then they will expect you to be, I don't know, the village, there's a responsibility of me to do something. When the road is bad, they don't expect me to bring a trailer to grade it, but they expect me to at least contribute half a three pound of quartz to fill it up. But if you are a corporate farmer, online, they don't care. They are either going to demand the government, if you want us to come and farm in your state, you're going to do the road, you need to do the infrastructure, you need to do this, and when government are giving them all of this, everything that they land on the farm, they don't pass it to the local farmers. We don't need to go to the government and see how many native indigenous farmers is doing what they are doing. No, they don't pass the knowledge. And finally, the other group of people that do farming are the elites. That is the rich people of this world. They go into farming But they were going to family because as an hobby, as a child, at the farm, the minister that I was talking about, probably I've always been dreaming. Probably his friend in America has a farm. And she used to say, let me have a farm. Let me be able to brag with my farm. But when farms are running that way, it's not running efficiently. Because if you're not keeping an eye on your cost and your returns, the farm will eventually run down, even if you have all the money in the world. Because farm can easily become a big one that will be swallowing money and not returning it back. If it's not well managed. And when I finished my study in 1989, there were a lot of indigenous farms, poultry farms in Nevada. I traveled when I came back 10 years ago, it's only the Lebanese that have got the poultry farm, almost 99% of poultry farm in Nevada. If I had a farm where I did my IT, that would be not an indigenous, he eventually sold it to the Lebanese, or lease it, or whatever. So when I came back, there are no more indigenous farm. Why? Because the owner totally dies, and the farm disappears. So here we're talking about how to have long-term plan for our farms. We don't want to invest all this money in the structure and everything, and then we disappear and the farm is run down. We have to start looking at it, and that's where we come in. And that's where we come in. I believe that what Nigeria need are middle-class farmers, and that's the category that we fall into. And that's one of the things one of the reasons why I do trading. I don't do trading for generals, I don't do trading for big people, I do trading for people like-minded. Because research has shown that over the last 3 years, Nigeria has had a large size of middle class. And we're going to look at why they are unique, why they are better off to make Nigeria, to improve that, to take Nigeria farming from subsistence to commercial. The only category of them is the farm whereby, like all of you guys, I don't expect you sitting down on the farm 7 days a week running the farm. But I expect you to have a good grip of your farm. I expect you to employ people. And that's what differentiates a small old farming from a middle class farm. Because as the owner of the farm, you need to be strategic. You need to always, you don't want to bog yourself down to the core in the day-to-day. You need to have time to think, to strategize the marketing. Hence, that's one of the reasons why you came here. Because there's a lot of work to do. If you have farm already, there's a lot of work to do in your farm today. Today is Friday. There's a lot of sweeping. There's a lot of compounding. But your approach, that's why middle class are the people that are going to take farming, Nigerian farming from subsistence farmer to commercial farmer. Because most of the labor is provided by hired workers. So you have people that you employ. So not only are you doing justice for yourself, you're employing people as well. They said they normally have between, according to FAO, middle class farmers may have between 5 to 9 acres. Or if it's farmed, they are projecting to have more than 200 pigs. Because then you have 200 pigs, you are commercial, because you already turned that to 1,000 before you blink your eyes. I'm not very careful. I know what I'm talking about. So what they're saying is that they look beyond just they look at building their farm up. They don't want to become a passenger farm tomorrow, but they are building their farm up based on how much they have and how much profitable the farm is, and the right to expand it. They said middle class farmer will enjoy two things. He will keep a closer eye on his investment, and he's not bogged down with it. Let's look at it a little more. Just I feel like in the last few years, the middle class in Nigeria is becoming bigger. And that's because a lot of us are doing jobs now that allow us to be able to go beyond just paying our children's school fees or feeding our children, but give us enough to be able to save, to be able to invest for our future. Not only that, there are a lot of diaspora that are coming. Most of the people that came last week are diaspora, to the train last week are diaspora. Or people that sent the diaspora, they sent their brother here to come for the training because they realize that they are planning to come back at some point and they want to make sure they have a solid base to come back from. That's very peculiar of medical. They always think things through. Research has shown that the driving force of most successful nations in the world are always done by middle class. What are the advantages of middle class? Who are these middle class? Who are we looking at? People that have land close to the city or have access to land in their village. They have capital to invest because pig farming initially will consume some money. We're going to be looking at the figures. I'm going to be very frank with you. I'm going to give you a very good idea of what you're getting yourself into. So you know, you need to have some steady income or savings to be able to start big farming. Like some of it, if you come from their savings, they have collateral. As your farm expands and you're making profit, you will be willing to take even more risk. But as your farm, as you spend your money and you're going to start getting returns back, because If agriculture is always economy of scale. It takes, I was telling somebody, he wanted to start this farm, and I said, you can start with 10 and two, 10 females and 2 males. We're going to need to start. If you also start with 20 females and 2 males, you're still going to need to start. So you have to balance it. So you want to, if you're serving in something small, you might be losing, you have to balance it very well. Because if you're having, you need to start whatever the size of, if you even have 50 pigs, you need to start. So all the time, you'll be looking at that, don't worry about it now, but there's some fundamental about economy of scale that your cost of production will stop at a certain level, even though your production is increasing. That's a good example. Okay, you have 20, you have to start. You have 10, you have to start too. By you are doubling your staff performance by having much, but we'll look at that in more detail. They produce specific product that meets market. Many people ask me, is there a market for pigs? And most of the time what they're asking me is not market for pigs, they're asking me whether there's sales for pigs. But we're going to look at sales and marketing, how they play together. Because one of the challenges that when we started about 7 years ago was the challenge of making pigs to be appealing to people, because the pig and pork has very bad image. But over the last 5 years, some of the work we've done and everybody has done, and the economic situation has made people start looking at pig again. And hence, you are here, because now pig is becoming very interesting. So, there's this business opportunity. Okay, why is middle class farmer very important? It says Africa needs more hands, not more hands than playing farmers. We don't need more farmers. If you're already 65%, 70% farming, how many do you want? And we cannot feed ourselves. The remaining 30% will not be able to do that. So what do we need to feed ourselves? Research shows that Nigeria, Ethiopia, and Burundi, they have 70% of their population farmer. Ethiopia is even worse, 80%, yet they have farming right now in Ethiopia. And Burundi has 93.6% of their people farming actively, yet they cannot feed themselves. Now, Canada, UK, and South Africa, they have less than 20%. Actually, in South Africa, has less than 10% of the people farming, yet they're able to provide, feed themselves. So there seems to be a correlation between the number of people that are doing farming, because the more of you that are doing it efficiently, doesn't make up. So, where you come in, where you and I comes in, Nigeria needs you, Africa needs you, and it's so important that we realize that when we are doing pig farming, we are not just doing it in the national neighborhood, that will change the history of this nation if we continue at this pace. When we are doing centenary of Nigeria, we are talking about founding father. I believe it's our time. Yesterday is history. What our founding fathers did, I won't know. I think it's gone. It's history. Tomorrow, we don't know what's going to happen, but today is the gift. So, this is our time to do what we can do. That news is in April 2017. Most of us in Nigeria don't know most of these things very well because it doesn't come closer to us. We are in Nigeria, but it doesn't come closer to us. When I saw this, it shook me that Nigeria, people who die of hunger in Nigeria, a land that has a queen and king, that have senators. That's Financial Times. Starvation in the northern part of Nigeria, where we are still alive. We have it wrong. I like this quote. I'll put it in Nigerian way. Say, let us therefore brace ourselves to our duty. So be ourselves that if Nigeria and the 36 states last for 1,000 years, let me say that this was our finest moment. This is very important because one of my goals today is to challenge you. One of my goals is to make you to realize that the little thing that you think you're about to start now has a bigger implication. Yesterday, 2 days ago, I got a call from NK. They want to come and do the recording at the farm training tomorrow. In my wildest day when I started, I never thought I would ever have anything like this. I'm not politically minded, politically oriented. It's another quote. It said, we shall feed our country, whatever the cost may be. This quote was actually given when the United Kingdom was in trouble. And I believe if there's going to be starvation in Nigeria like it used to be in Ethiopia, in Nigeria, we're in trouble. This is beyond ethnicity. This is beyond religion. This is serious. People say that if a prophet prophesied that there's going to be famine, it has to be careful because his children are not going to eat gravel. about the challenge that we have today. So things that we're talking today has a lot of ramification into what is going on. But what concerns us most is the shortage in animal protein challenge. Now we're coming to pig. Why are you a pig farmer? Why has the pig suddenly changed recently? Why? So I'm talking about agriculture as a whole, but we need to know why the pig change become something that we have training on. So 5 years ago, I did a training like this for Shusen government. The training was subsidized heavily by Shusen. They only asked the farmers to come and pay 10,000. So the government paid the rest. But you know most of the farmers, because most of them fall into the that shocked me, because then I realized how most farmers in Nigeria are not well trained. Government subsidized and they only said pay 10,000, they could not pay. Eventually, I had to allow them to come in because, as just as myself, I'm going to use the same energy, let me come in. So it's what they said. But here you are, big, 75 years later, we are ready to look at it in a bigger way. We are having problems in Nigeria. There's not enough meat. Most people, we might not notice this because if you're middle class, but most people, when they want to eat, they weigh it where they don't eat meat in their food. And when we start looking at what the reason is, according to FAO, they said it was because Nigeria is dependent on cattle and poultry, on very few. 170 million of us are dependent on just two sorts of animal protein, which is beef and poultry. We have less than a cow, which account for 50% of the animal that we eat in Nigeria. We have, according to the FAO, we have 22 million cows in Nigeria. Now, you are wondering why there's a problem between Fulani and the herdsmen. If you have 22 million people and 22 million cows, they're going to drink 1 billion gallons of water a day. So if you dig a hole, or borehole, or well, and you don't find water in it, it's not like it's not raining. If the group of is consuming 1 billion gallons of water, you might not see the 1 billion gallons of water, but that's how much they have to consume to survive. So they are drinking it from somewhere. If they have to consume 1 billion and they consume 500 million kilograms of grass, now you see why they, as long as this population continues to increase and there's plenty of the food and the price is going, according to the law of demand, and the price is going up. Cow, I remember 4 years ago when I bought a big cow, it was about 120. I'm told now that the same cow will cost about 250, 300. Now you see a full animal having 100 cows going with him. That means he has 30 million naira worth of cattle going. Now you plant your whole cassava and your maize. If they harvest, if they wait till the end of it and they harvest it, it's less than 1 million. You can now begin to understand why, except something is done, they keep on taking the risk. That's why they can afford Kalashnikovs, AK-47. Because what they are carrying, we think they are carrying cattle, but they look at them, they are carrying 30 million people that we have to sustain every day. So you have to hit grass, somebody's farm, to do with it, to feed them, to keep them alive, and to keep them growing. We'll do it. Now, and according to the Nigeria is about 3.3 million, I don't agree with that because I was calculating with thinking. We eat a lot. As long as we continue, all the 170 million of us begin to continue to eat cattle and poultry, the demand will continue to be high, the price will be high, the food and people will be ready to take more risk. So what do we propose? We propose what we are proposing as pig, one thing we are trying to tell the government is this, that as proposing a bill for cattle, to have cattle session, government need to start looking at pig farming. And my experience with Arabesha Governor, His Excellency Arabesha, when I had the last meeting with him on one-to-one, I realized the government has started looking, because even the governor is far, far, far knowledgeable in terms of the role that pork can play in the state. And why is that very important to us? It's very important to us in that we are setting up a big farming now with the trend of things. I believe within the next 1 or 2 years, NTA didn't just call us for nothing. They must have been wanting a way of promoting pig production. And I believe we are well positioned if we can get our farm right, our production right when it's still very small. When subsidy, when money and things and loans will start coming to pig farming in a big way, we'll be well positioned. And one of my goals today is to make sure that we get some fundamental right on our pig production We'll be looking at every detail, and that's why I say, as we go along, please, if you have any questions, please don't hesitate to ask me. Because right now we are finishing the historical part of this production. We're going to go into the real core. So if all of this is in your slide, what I've done there was to put a lot of the thoughts. For example, let me give you a good example. Right now, most of us, when we produce paper, I don't do a good presentation in the middle of the day. Most of what we produce paper, the waste. In my family, we just shredded into the bush. And we plant there, so that by default, the plantain, the pawpaw, and all the things we plant there, will be taking advantage of it. I went to one family, the farm we did the training last week, which was one of my approaches. He has taken another step. He did about digester. I'm going to show you in the video before we finish. He did about digester. And that about digester is using his waste and turning it into, put it in water. Very simple, I'll show you. Very simple. And was able to produce gas enough to be able to light and cook food on his farm. And because he was successful in that, he's now digging the ground. He just used this four-corner white plastic to do it. If I'm going to show you the video, and if anybody is interested, I don't even mind giving the contact, because I believe that's the future. Now, for a small farm, he's able to produce enough gas for all the staff to cook. And you know, in big production, that sometimes you cook food, to cook your food for pigs. We don't talk about that. So instead of him going to fetch wood, he's using the gas to cook the food. So he connected to a gas cooker, and he's using it. And the proprietor of that farm is saying that his plan is to dig and find a generator that will run by gas from the waste of pigs. Now, why is that very important? If one of the things we are going to propose to the government is that we should have farm settlement so that we can all put our poo-poo together. And if we do that, based on the calculation we said, if we give us 50,000 acres of land, we'll be able to win 10 million pigs. And 10 million pigs produce enough waste to be able to generate 500 megawatts of power. All the things you're going to do in that kind of settlement that produce 10 million, there has to be a generator, the cold room, there has to be an abattoir, there has to be a pumping machine, there has to be electricity and everything. When we calculate how much electricity we're going to be using, we're going to be using about 300 megawatts. That's 50,000 hectares. And the 200 megawatts left we generate for the government of whatever investor put money, another 190 million naira per year, or $190 million per year. Suddenly, it's going beyond peak. It's going. The reason why I'm going this far is I want to blow our mind that what we are trying to do, yes, we are starting small. Yes, our beginning is small. But where we can take it to is very, very big. And as middle class business, one of the things I said earlier is that we have opportunity to do some things and say, okay, I want to do pig production, but I'm not going to do abattoir. Or in my farm, I don't want to produce it. What I want to produce is winners. I want to be producing winners because I want to turn it around very quickly. We're going to look at that very quickly. Many of us don't do that. We just do everything. And when you do everything, it can be very costly. You need to be loaded. But a different way you can diversify and focus on an aspect and make a lot of money there. So that's just the electricity we can produce. But we're going to do that if all the farmers are in an area and we can connect all the people together. The same thing with organic fertilizer. Like you just spend a lot of money on organic fertilizer. When you produce gas from waste, what is left is fertilizer. When you take the poo, when you put it on your farm, it won't work. If you take big poo and put it on your, it won't work. And I won't burn it because of the uric acid that is there. But when you allow it to decompose, what is left with fertilizer? So as you are using part of it to make electricity, what is left is organic fertilizer. And you know how much fertilizer is. And organic fertilizer is even better than the chemical fertilizer that we're getting. I'm saying this because, like I said, I want them to start thinking beyond just pig farming. But before we do that, so in your slide, you see what I did there was put a scenario together of what can happen if we become very good in pig production and we expand. I was telling somebody one day that when I was in the UK, I met a Chinese exporter, and I was asking him, how much you want to export pigs to China? And he was telling me, Jenny, the minimum we expect from you is 2,000 every month. When I saw that, I said, wow, dude, and we need 12 months MOU with you. To supply that, I will need 30,000 pigs. Now, there's no way right now I can produce 30,000 pigs. But it occurred to me that if one of us, if each one of us produce 1,000 things each, we can even make, we can even meet that supply. And that's where people actually, everyone didn't get so much information out, I get so much information out about people production on the YouTube. Because I believe it's important that we black people start realizing that holding information doesn't make you smarter. But I get it from somewhere, so if I share, you don't need to start from where I start, you can start from where I stop and move it forward. That's why I was talking to you about this guy who took about that just I told him how to use the waste to fertilize. He took it from there to actually use this gas. Maybe one of you guys, by the time you come here, you're gonna have a plan that generates electricity. So that's the background to, that's the way I want us to be looking at pig farming. But this is just the youngest producing thing. The potential is very big, and where we can go with it is very hard. It was here again that said this before he died. He said, ask not what your country can do for you, but ask what you can do for your country. As I said earlier, this is our time, and this is our time to make a contribution, and we would by the grace of God. Thank you very much.